ahead and stand up and let's have a good time this morning.
Psalm 24:7-10. Open up ancient gates, open up ancient doors, and let the King of Glory enter. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord invincible in battle. Open up ancient gates, open up ancient doors, and let the King of Glory enter. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord of Heaven's armies. He is the King of Glory.
Amen. We'll go ahead and have our welcome time at this time as well. He said he was 27.
Who, Kenny?
No. Billy.
Oh, Billy's 27. I thought Billy was Kenny was going to start something else, you know. He starts rumors and stuff. So. Well, let's have prayer together, okay? Let's do that. Oh, wow. Father, we're just delighted to be able to come and be together. And Father, we are most happy and most delighted to come into your presence and to fellowship with you, with each other. I pray, Father, that we could enjoy your presence, all of us in this room, that it would be a unique time. Father, we recognize your presence, and we recognize your love for us, that it's perfect. And Lord, we would ask that you would teach us some things that would make life better, to help us to see you better, to help us to see ourselves and one another, and that we could be honest. So help us. May our faith be purified. May our love be genuine. I pray that our joy would be rich. And I pray these things. Thanking you for these birthdays. Bless those guys and their families. We pray in Jesus' name.
So before we sing this next song, we're going to actually say the Lord's Prayer, if you guys don't mind saying that with us.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
4:12, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved.
Celebrate the one who sacrificed for our sin. Amen.
Father, now we give you thanks and praise for this day. We thank you, sir, for what Christ has done for us on the cross. And we always give honor for what he gave in his life on Calvary's cross to give us a home in heaven and give us abundant life here on earth. We thank you, sir, for forgiveness of our sins and our past. And we do not have a past this day. We thank you for the name of Jesus and what he has done. We give you thanks for this time of communion to always remember. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. The scripture says this: for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by the grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as the propitiation or mercy seat by his blood through faith, to demonstrate his righteousness. We give thanks that we are justified by the blood of Christ, the sacrifice, the one sacrifice that can take care of all of humanity from beginning to end. That's how great he is. We give thanks. Revelation 1 says, the blood of Jesus washes away our sin.
You can stand with us. Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. We've got a new song, another new song this morning.
Weary traveler, beat down from all the storms that you have weathered. It's like this road just might go on forever. Carry on, you keep on giving. This world just keeps on taking. Your tired heart is on the edge of breaking. Carry on. Weary traveler, restless soul, you were never meant to walk this road.
I do want to say this prayer. We want to pray again for Kaylee. Cassie is here. She's been staying with Kaylee a day and night, and her family's all right here, and we're delighted to have you guys here. So we want to continue to remember Kaylee, and we want to continue to remember Teresa as well. Teresa Cecil, she's around here somewhere. There she's back there in the back. So Teresa, we're glad you're here, and she has a lot going on with her as well, and the Lord's taking care of her. But we want to continue to pray for her. She has this tumor on her pituitary gland. So, glad you're here. We get to enjoy the Lord together. So I want to lead us in a prayer and thank you guys for your music, for your worship. It's good for us. Let's pray together. Father, we do want to recognize you again. And Lord, we want to recognize that you have taken care and that you are taking care of Kaylee. That accident was bad, but you have preserved her, and you are bringing healing to her. We thank you. We pray for Teresa as she goes forward, and she wants wisdom to know what paths to take, and she listens to her doctors. And so, Father, we're asking for your favor in healing her. Lord, we thank you for this time. We want to give it to you. We just want for you to speak to us. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, what we're doing this morning is we're going to be referring to those churches in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. And I will do so in a moment. But we're going to start with Ephesians 2, verses 19 to 22. Ephesians 2, 19 to 22. And I always like it when Ronnie sits up close. I can keep a better eye on him. You guys know Ronnie Ragsdale? Surely you know Ronnie Ragsdale. You don't know him? Yeah. So this is always good to have him right here, because he would have to sit at the front of the class anyway. This morning, you know, one of the things about teaching the Bible is it's a humbling thing. It's a very humbling thing, and I hope that you prepare yourself as you come to hear the scriptures and to enjoy the Lord, that you not only enjoy the fellowship, but you also hope to be challenged in some way, right? Because we're all changing. We all are changing, right? I mean, I could look at pictures of myself 30 years ago and look at them today. Man, I've changed a lot, and right? And then you can consider, you know, things that you have solidified and that you're solidifying in your own mind, things that you know are true, and they're just getting richer and richer about God, about our view of each other, about our view of ourselves, and so forth. And so I hope that you want to be challenged in your own life. The title of the message is "The Church Is Much Holier, Really, Than It Seems," and we'll touch on that a little bit. But I want you to know that that when my kids were younger, I just want to make this illustration. I think it's really important. When my kids were younger and in the home, you know, we had certain rules. I mean, they weren't severe or anything. I mean, sometimes I had to ground them for 14 years, but other than that, but no, seriously, I didn't, girls, I did, I promise. But, you know, there were certain rules that we had at home that we didn't have, you know, that I saw differently when I left my home or even with my own kids. Let me give you an example. Back in the late 90s and the early 2000s, my kids always wanted MTV. Now, I don't know, you know, some of you guys know about MTV. I haven't seen it at all in probably 10 or 15, 20 years. I don't even know. But I do know that back then, I didn't allow my kids to watch MTV. They always asked me to get it in our home. You could pay for it or whatever. I don't remember how that worked, but we didn't get those channels. We just got like four channels or something, and really not many. And but we didn't have it. I didn't want them to watch MTV at that time in their lives. They were young teenagers and older teenagers and so forth, and I didn't do that. Now, I do know that my kids, when they went to other friends' homes, that they were watching MTV, but it didn't bother me. I mean, I was just going to teach what was right in our home and what I felt was best for them, but I wasn't going to police that. I didn't even ask them about it later, you know, but little things that they would say, I knew that they were watching it, but it didn't bother me. And I'll tell you why, because I knew that what I wanted to do was to teach them a certain way, and I knew that that stuff would take hold eventually. I believed that it would. Like my son, for example, right now, I'm watching him, and he's raising his kids, and they got my grandkids a phone recently, right? And my son has put such a lock on it, I can't even call him, okay? So I had to call him and say, John, man, I'd like to be able to, you know, text him or whatever, you know, and of course he did, you know, but I think he purposely, no, I'm just kidding. But the point is that, you know, those kind of things, but I want you to know something, and we're going to read something together here, is I want you to understand that this is God's church. It's not mine. It's His. This is important to know. In fact, I don't want you to forget this. This is a divine entity. It is something that God did. It is something that He's been doing for over 2,000 years. He's been doing the church. He's been doing it. I know that He allows us to participate in it, but He's the one doing the church, and so we have to listen to Him. We want to do in His church, we want to be a part of the church that He wants to do the work. And He wants to be our teacher. He is our teacher. He is the Lord of it, right? He's Lord of the church. He's the shepherd of the church. He's the head of the church. So therefore, that's what we do here this morning, is we want to be challenged in such a way. By the way, this challenge is always filled with grace. It's always filled with grace. And you know, one of the things that you're going to find in the passage that we're going to read today is going to be kind of fun. One thing I want you to know is that, you know, God does talk about grace first. He talks about peace first. And He actually talks about, you're going to see it, we're going to learn the love of God first. We want to learn the love of God first as we look at these challenges before us here at First Christian. That's extremely important that we do this. So I hope that you kind of see the foundation here. The foundation is it's His church. And so He's the master, He's the head of it, and we want to follow His lead. This is His church. It's not ours. And it never will be ours. It is His. And so that's what we want to do. If you'll bring up those three thoughts just real quickly for me, and I'll come back to that. Thank you, Preston, for putting that up there. But because Christ is the head of the church, there are specific things He wants and does not want for the family. Okay? Secondly, because the Father chose you before the foundation of the world, which, by the way, your head should just be like blown up, man, to think about that His affection was set on you before the foundation of the world. I mean, that's mind-boggling. It's exciting. It's affirming, but before the foundation of the world, to be holy, how can we not live to please Him in all of our ways, right? We're going to see all this in the Scriptures. Because the Holy Spirit is active in you, there is no other direction your heart, mind, and body can go but toward holiness. It's the Holy Spirit, for goodness sakes. So let's go, let's do this. I want to, first of all, show you here in Ephesians 2, we're back to that, verse 19. It says this, "Now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God." That's pretty critical. Members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Let's talk about this for a minute. In fact, Dr. Owens and I were talking recently, just the other day. It was a really good conversation that we had. And I know he's going, uh-oh, man, what did I say? But it was exactly right in the world in which we live, we have no business going around condemning anybody. We have no business in any form. I'm very comfortable with whatever things are going on in people's lives. But here's the kicker is that in the church, there's certain things that we have to teach and then let the Lord work in the hearts of people. And there are certain things that we believe that not to try to fit into culture, but to fit in with the a family of God. To teach what God wants his family to know. That's what we have to do. Okay? I would not go, for example, to a gay pride rally or march or whatever and condemn people. See? I would not do that. There's no reason for me to do that. Now listen to me very carefully. The world does what the world does. We don't want to make a bunch of Pharisees, people who are dead on the inside but look good on the outside. See? And so this is something that God does. He's the one who changes people's lives and we cannot. But the church comes back to it. Now we've got to look at the scriptures and see what they actually had to say to us. Okay? So, because Christ is the head of the church and the builder of the church, therefore, we want to respond to him. Look at Ephesians chapter 5, if you'll look at this with me. Ephesians 5, you'll bring that up, and it goes like this. Therefore, this is so good. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love. I mean, this is we're children of God, right? Because of Christ. As Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. Verse 3. But in this family, fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you. Right? As is fitting for saints. Verse 4, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. Don't you love that? Verse 5, for this you know, that no fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of God and of Christ. And what this literally means is that when you live a lifestyle of these things, all of a sudden you become exposed. Because all of us have committed one or two or three or five of those, whatever the case may be. But the bottom line is how we live. Because of the Holy Spirit in our lives. See? So, but it begins with the love of God. It begins with let's imitate him in God's love for us. That's where he wants us to begin. You see? I wrote a letter to our denomination, and I let them know some concerns that I had. I wrote a letter to the heads of the denomination, there's four of them that I knew about, plus one over our region. And I let them know what I was teaching, what our elders supported. And so we wrote that letter. And we literally did not get a response from them at all. Not one response, not a phone call, not a letter, anything. And then, so what we did, and I just want you to hear this for a moment. I just want to kind of put this out there. That what we did, when I would go down, because I was going to become certified within the Disciples of Christ, and I went down and I would have meetings with different pastors. Sometimes as many as 16 or 17 of them whenever I was there, and I was on Zoom because we have three states. There are three states, Louisiana, Mississippi, and Arkansas. And so I was there, and for some reason, the whole time I was there, I had to spend talking about LGBTQ+I and all that. And I had to dig my way out of that. That's what I talked about every time I went down. Like, I would just, we'd go down there, and by the time I got there, some people were already mad at me. And that, by the way, this is before I wrote my letter. Okay, so it's not like, so it was just, it was a very interesting time. Then I went to a pastor's meeting. By the way, that happened every single time I encountered, and I had some people got really mad at me, you know, and I'm really a nice guy, you know, I was nice. But then I went to a meeting, and we were studying about Abraham and Hagar and Sarah. Those of you guys who know that story, Abraham and Sarah decided they were going to help God out by having a child, so they brought Hagar into the mix. Hagar has a child, and Sarah's jealous, and so Abraham and Sarah, really Sarah, sent Hagar away. Well, God came to Hagar, and he showed mercy to her, but in this discussion with the pastors, one pastor who got up to speak was so mad at God because how he treated Hagar. And I'm like, you know, I was just listening, but I was like, do you know who he is? I mean, now, I'm not saying he didn't know him, but I'm saying like God, you know, you're going to get mad at God in this situation? I mean, and then another pastor got up and he said, look, what you need to do, and he was telling the pastors, you need to go to your imam, which is a leader, teacher in the Muslim faith. You need to go there, and then you need to go and worship with him, you know. And in this denomination, we've actually had times where there was an imam speaking at one of our events to talk about how we can all get together and work together. And so, by the way, the reason why Allah is not the same God, you need to know this, is because he didn't have a son named Jesus who died for our sins, which is really critical. So if that's the case, then it's not the same God. Do you understand that? It's something different. All right? So whenever these kinds of things are constantly going on, you gotta step back, guys. We gotta step back and go, wait a minute, is this something that we want to be a part? Because anytime someone learns about the denomination, every time they find out about it, they're like confused as to our participation. Another thing that they did is they passed some resolutions, and these resolutions said things like this, that if there are institutions, schools, institutions that require leaders to tell parents that their children are transitioning, then we need to protest that. Does that make sense? In other words, if there's a policy at Jonesboro High School or whatever school here, and their policy is to report to parents that their child is transitioning, they're changing from a male to a female, that we're against that kind of policy because the child, you know, emotional state, we want to protect a child's emotional state. Well, here's the problem. The parent knows more about the child than the school does or any other institution. God gave the child to the parent. So you follow me? These kind of things begin to really start to add up. And by the way, don't miss this, okay? That there's a trajectory going on here. There's a trajectory. It's going, I mean, L, G, B. I mean, stop and think about what each one of these are, right? And each one. And then it's the plus. Well, what's the plus? Well, man, I mean, there's a whole lot more. There's the whole non-binary. I mean, you know what non-binary means? It means neither male nor female. I mean, you know, how can you do that? Watch this. See, it's a rebellion against what God said. Here's what he said in Matthew 19, for example, in Matthew 5. Here it is. God created male and female. That's it. So either the Bible's the authority or the God's the authority. We're not smarter than God in any form. 1 Corinthians 1 says the wisdom of man is foolishness to God. So be very attentive. This book right here is so freeing. It will free you up. It will not bind you. It will not bind you. It will free you like you've never been free before. It just does. It's not. In fact, we're dealing with maybe some negative things. And don't you know, this book right here talks about how that the love of God, how that is given to you. It talks about how that you can have peace and joy and faith, and talks about how that now you don't have to be bound by sin anymore, and you can be free from it. And it goes on and on. There's so many positive things about the Bible. It just keeps coming at you, and it'll overwhelm you. There's so many good things that come your way because of the Bible. So many promises. Okay, so let me just talk here for just a moment. I don't know if we can bring this up or not. Preston, we never can conclude that. Will that work or not? Okay, let's do it. Let's pull that out. Oh, you said no? I don't know what you're saying to me. I can't see. It does or doesn't?
No.
No, okay, got it. Oh, he was going, I mean, I couldn't, the lights were there, and he's going this, and I'm thinking he's going this. Okay? So what this video is, okay, here's the video that I'll share with you that we were trying to pull up. It's a conference, and it was just recently, it's this year, and it was a men's conference called the Stronger Men's Conference. And what they had, how they began it, was things like they had, you know, like a tank, and they ran over cars. That's cool, right? No big deal. But what they had was, are you ready for this? It was a men's conference, and they kind of had a male stripper. Girls, don't get excited, okay? There was a male stripper. And, of course, he didn't take everything off, but it was really kind of weird. Now, the guy, by the way, the male stripper, he became a believer. Don't misunderstand. He became a believer himself, and he'll testify to that. But that's kind of how it started, and he kind of got up on a pole and was, you know, all this kind of stuff. Anyway, you guys don't want to hear anymore. So, if you follow me, in other words, if we're going to spend our lives simply appealing to the flesh, we're going to go nowhere. Spiritually if we're not careful. Let's look at a couple of things. If you would, in 1 Thessalonians 4, would you turn that? Would you bring that up? 1 Thessalonians 4, and I want you to see this. Verses 3. We're going to read down through verse 8. Goes like this: For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality, right? Most people have experienced that, but I want you to notice that it says that each of you should know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor. Verse 5, not in passion and lust like the Gentiles who don't know God, right? Verse 6, that no one should take advantage of and defraud his brother in this matter, because the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also forewarned you and testified. Verse 7 says, for God did not call us to uncleanness, but to holiness. See? Therefore, he who rejects us does not reject man, but God, who has also given us his Holy Spirit. Now, watch this. Now, what I'm teaching you is what God wants for his family, right? This is what God wants for his family. And so there's nobody that's going to go around and try to police you and try to, you know, can we see your phone, please? Or can we see your, what's your computer? Or can we, you know, there's nobody that's going to do that. But we are going to teach what's right. We're going to teach what's right. And we know that God can speak to you. God can draw you. God can bring this kind of purity. Bring up Romans 6:19. This is a verse that Kenny will be getting to on Sunday nights in about 3 years. But verse 19 says, I speak, and I'm just kidding, man. He's going slow and easy. It's really good, Kenny. I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh, for just as you presented your members, your body, as slaves to uncleanness and of lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves of righteousness for holiness. So we see this, right? And what's so beautiful is that if we were to go to Galatians 5, we're not going to take the time, but if we were going to go to Galatians 5, the Bible says, look, if you walk in the Spirit, you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you walk in the Spirit, you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. And it's so beautiful because he talks about these things again, about how the flesh will take you this way, it'll take you this way. But the fruit of the Spirit, though, then it goes on. And it says the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and gentleness and long-suffering and faithfulness. And it goes, and against us there's no law. And you know what's so crazy about it is the Spirit of God is one who gives us joy. He gives us peace. He gives us he allows us to not get angry real quick, and all of these things. But watch this. And then right after the last verse, it says, and don't become conceited. I think that's hilarious, because you and I can have God do something through us that we get proud about it. You know what I'm saying? It's the craziest thing I've ever seen. You know, we're so prone to stuff. All of us are. We're all here. We're all prone to anything and everything. But if we walk in the Spirit, if we listen to the Spirit, if you read Ephesians chapter 3 and Colossians chapter 3, what you find is this, is the taking in the Word of God and being filled with the Spirit. By the way, that was Ephesians 5. I said 3, but Ephesians 5. Is that if walking in the Spirit and taking in the Word of God are synonymous. They're synonymous. They work together. They work together. And it's so beautiful. So you say, Don, you talked about Revelation and you haven't done that yet, so I'm going to do that right now real quickly. Now watch this. There are two churches, Smyrna and Philadelphia, that God didn't have to correct them. Here's what I'm going to say to you. Five of the churches God had to correct. He had to correct them. And it's so beautiful because he loved them. And he said, look, guys, some of you, for example, remember last week we talked about you left your first love. There were other ones who, they tolerated, you ready? They tolerated the woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality. So there was a church like that. Then there was another one, Sardis, that they said that they had a name, but in fact they had a name that they were rich, but in fact they were dead. And so what each of these churches that he talks about is, this is what he says. These five churches, five out of the seven, five of them, he says, look, guys, I'm telling you what you did. Repent. All five of them. Same word. Repent. Turn around. Remember what you were doing before. And it is so beautiful that he does this, guys. It's just so amazing to me. And so let me just kind of share, and I could go on and on. You know, there's a lukewarm church, and there's a compromising church, and there's a corrupt church, and all that. But let me try to close, okay? Let me try. Let me give it a shot. I just need to share with you some things. You see, some people will say things like, well, Don, you know, the Bible talks about homosexuality and things like that in the Old Testament. Well, it really does talk a lot about it in the New Testament, too. You can go to Romans 1. You can go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. It really does talk a lot about it. Jesus talked about it using certain words. Now, like, for example, let me ask you a question, just because I want to reason with you a little bit. In Leviticus 18, it talks about three basic sexual sins. By the way, the way I really want to deal with things in the future is the only thing you and I can celebrate is marriage between a man and a woman. That's the only thing we can celebrate. That's it. We don't get to celebrate anything else. We just don't. Not from a biblical perspective. Again, we're talking about God's family. You know, when it comes to, you know, friends, I have friends that are, you know, all kinds of things, man. I do. I've got friends that are. And you know, and they're going to be my friends. if I ever get, you know, it, when, if and when I get a chance to share Jesus with them, I will. But you know what? They're always going to be my friends regardless. Do you understand that? Regardless. Regardless. But Leviticus 18 talks about three things. Are you ready for this? Some of you, this is maybe PG-13 here. You ready? So Leviticus 18, one, it talks about incest a lot. It talks a lot about incest, how that's wrong, okay? And then it talks about, I'm going to say it real quickly, we'll move on, bestiality. Not going to go into that. Number three talks about homosexuality and that it's wrong. And so, you know, for some reason, people say, well, that's the Old Testament. Well, do you tell me which of those three are okay now? You know, which of the three? And by the way, here's the Bible says this, and I really am going to close now. But the Bible says this in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Rightly divide the word of God. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now here's how you know what goes from the Old Testament to the New Testament is simply now what's taught in the New Testament. You follow me? In other words, there's no more sacrifices. You don't find that in the New Testament. It's not there because we don't have sacrifices anymore. A lot of the cleanliness laws that they had in the Old Testament is not taught in the New Testament. But the moral law hasn't left. And I got to tell you, what the moral law will tell you need Jesus. That's the first and foremost, okay? And then I also want you to know that God will help you on your journey to live that out. Maybe when we get there, it'll be finally perfected. And I'm a long ways from it, by the way. I'm a long ways from it. But you know what? It's a lot of fun to do that, which is right. So here's the deal. I want y'all to consider some things. We're voting next week at 10 o'clock. And it should be a simple vote. That's the only thing we're voting on. And as a church, we want to go in that direction. Not everybody feels that way, but this is God's church and not ours, and it'll never be ours. We get to participate. I get to be here because God has allowed me to be here, and that's all. You get to participate. God has allowed you to be here. And so God has spoken to you and said, you know, Don, I'd like to be a part of a church that wants to go in the right direction, wants to go toward the Bible and not away from it. You say, Don, I'd like to be a part of that. Then I'd like to invite you to come and be a part of that. But before I go there, if someone here is here and they don't have Jesus in their heart, you don't have Christ as your Savior, that's the most important thing we could do here. Okay? God does all the rest. God does all the rest. So we're going to sing together. I'm going to pray right now. They're going to come, and if God's spoken to you, I want you to come. Would you do that? Let's pray together. Stand with me, would you? Father, I thank you that I get to be with this church. I do. I thank you. These are some beautiful people. I love their genuine faith. I love the fact that the love in their heart is growing. Lord, I thank you that you are in our lives. We love you, God. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. The Lord has spoken to you. We're going to sing together. I surrender all. If the Lord has spoken, you come. Would you do that? You come. Thank you. She's the director over there at the bungalows, and she took care of my mom when she was there. So she's really a cool lady. So let's see. And Paul, you've got an announcement or two.
Yes, sir.
And then you're going to close us in prayer, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay. Make sure.
A couple of announcements. Number one is there are copies of the Constitution we'll be voting on next Sunday. Here at 10 o'clock, please be here and encourage everyone that we know about to be here. And that Constitution, what it does is transition us out of disciples of Christ into being an independent church. It's what it will do when you vote for it. Let me say, too, that at 2 o'clock today, we have a regular board meeting in Fellowship Hall, and following that at approximately 3:30, if you get questions or comments you want to make about that proposal, please be here. I'll be here, or the others will be here to talk about that. But the key thing, 10 o'clock next Sunday is the vote here. If you'll bow in prayer with me, please.
Hey, Paul, can I interrupt you?
Oh, yes, you sure can.
Okay, so
Danny's
joining too.
Oh.
And
yeah.
Danny, you know, he's only been here for 5 years, you know. and I beg him like every week if he'll join, and he always tells me no. And so make sure you give him a hug too. So Danny, yeah. We'll have to call when he sees the paper though, okay? But he's not really one to get in front of everybody. I don't know. He's shy. You know he's shy.
You talking about Danny right here?
I am.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Good stuff. And anyway, a miracle we have in here today. So, and I'm kind of kidding. But I am all God. Sorry, Paul. That, you know,
that's great. That's great. I love that. Anybody else joining too? Please. All right. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we have been. This has been a great service. You have blessed us with Don. And his sermons, and you have injected into him what he is to say. And we just thank you, Lord. We thank you for Don. We thank you for all these people. We thank you for these that have come forward and are joining today. May we welcome them in the way that First Christian Church welcomes members. And as we go from here, May we read our scriptures. May we meditate about what we are doing and come back convicted in what our motion, what we are to do. We pray this through Jesus, and we all say, Amen. Amen.